evening is not my usual climate change spiel. It's specifically aimed at this problem of trying to attribute a very variable system. The global climate system is naturally very variable. How do we know that what we see as variation is firstly change, and then secondly, change caused by what? Because unless you understand what the causality is, you're very limited in applying solutions. You might be applying for the human solution. So, this is the formal set of definitions. There'll be a test afterwards. But basically, within the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, fifth assessment report has this glossary, and this is how it defines those particular things. Detection is simply a statistical process to say something is not what it was at some predefined previous time. So you just use a statistical approach to look for trend detection, or in a non-continuous variable, you're looking for a change between one time and another time. Relatively straightforward, and you know, the detection of climate change is now, as we'll get onto in a moment, a done deal. You know, the only people who still deny that the climate has changed are kind of a subset of the people who think that the world is flat, or you know, that the sun goes around the earth or whatever. It's the same deal, you know, because the evidence is absolutely clear. They're really, you know, there's no debate about it. So if you're still going to deny that the climate has changed against the pre-industrial period, it must mean that you have some other motive. It doesn't fit with your worldview or your particular vested interest. That certainly is not supported by the data. So really, what the legitimate debate is about is around the attribution thing, about how can we define the relative contributions in a complex system which has multiple causality. So that's a given. There's many things which influence the climate dynamics. How do we assign relative weights to natural phenomena, orbital forcing, and then of course human effects? And that's the big thing. So just to dispose of the sort of background, these are statements out of the IPCC fifth census report. Warming of the climate system is unequivocal. Okay, so now the IPCC uses this very measured set of uncertainty language. They didn't have a term that was strong enough for how clear climate change was, so they used unequivocal. There's no debate. This is not 99% of certainty. It's not 99.9%. It is unequivocal. The climate has changed. Get over it. Okay, and then they say, the human influence on the climate system is clear, okay? And that's the sort of unpacking that I'll be doing this evening. And in order to do that, you really need to be able to say, what are the unique attributes that would separate a human-caused climate signal from all the other potential causes? So the first thing you do is you exclude all the known causes. So whenever I kind of give a climate change talk, there's always someone in the audience who puts up their hand and says, what about volcanoes? Volcanoes are in, guys. What about Milankovitch cycles? Milankovitch cycles are in as well. So all of that stuff is considered. All of that is built into the models. All of that is tested. Everything that you can think of. Okay, everything that we know has an influence, a material influence on the climate is considered. And if you eliminate all those, you're kind of left with, as I think it was Sherlock Holmes who said, you know, once you've eliminated the impossible, no matter what's left, no matter how implausible, must be true. Well, you know, actually, strictly speaking, scientifically, that's not true. That's induction, okay? It's not proof, but it's strong induction. And then, in addition to that, you've got to make sure that the positive causes, the things that you left with, the things that you're saying are causing it, in this case, buildup of radiatively active substances in the atmosphere largely, are in fact correlated in the way that you suggest with the determined signal. If they also have no correlation, well then, case closed, okay. So they have to be positively correlated, but as you all know, correlation is not causation. That by itself is not sufficient evidence. So we then have a whole bunch of things, and that's this here, which are kind of uniquely associated with the mechanisms that are proposed for the warming of the world. So, for instance, if the world was simply rebounding from a medieval ice age, which is one of the sort of standard arguments, the climate is warming, but what happened was it was really cold in the 16th century, and we're still warming up after that, and it will plateau and go down again. If that were true, we would expect to see certain characteristic signals from that. For instance, it would be warming more or less equally everywhere, and the nighttime temperatures and the daytime temperatures would be warming equally, and it would be warming equally at different levels in the atmosphere. All of those things, are not true. Whereas if the forcing is due to the absorption of infrared radiation, shortwave radiation by these radiatively active gases in the atmosphere, it has a different set of characteristic symptoms. And that has been pointed out for a long time. In fact, the first guy who pointed this out was a guy called Tyndall back in about 1850. He was the first guy who worked on the absorption of infrared gases, infrared radiation by gases. And he posited that the world would warm up as a result of the rising CO2 in the atmosphere. That was 150 years ago. And he also posited it would have certain patterns. It would rise more in the nighttime than would in the daytime, because that's when the re-radiation, predominant re-radiation from the Earth is taking place. It would be stronger in the winter than it would be in the summer. If you work through the physics of this, you would expect the lower atmosphere to warm and the upper atmosphere actually to cool. Okay, all of these are evidences for that kind of mechanism. We would also expect, for more complicated reasons, to see a bigger signal in the poles and subtropics than we see in the tropics and temperate regions. Okay, and I think, that relates to temperature signals. In terms of the rainfall signal, basically a warmer world is a wetter world, because, and we know that from paleo records. So when we reconstruct past climates of the world, we know that in times when it was much colder, it was much drier, and in times when it was warmer, it was wetter. So strong evidence that the world system behaves like that. And so we would inspect, in fact, that a warmer world would also be associated with greater rainfall. But it's very patchy because of the dynamics of rainfall. But there are some things we can say. And one is that when you warm the world, you increase the kind of strength, the intensity of the hydrological cycle. And what that leads to is more intense rainfall rather than necessarily more storm events. So there's been a long debate, for instance, about whether extreme cyclonic rainfall events have gone up or not infrequently. It's a difficult data problem. But what is clear is that their intensity is going up. So it's not at all clear that the number of tropical typhoons has gone up, but their intensity has gone up. Okay, so that is all still inferential logic. It doesn't prove the case. It's just strong inference. It's adding more and more layers into, the probability that that's the best explanation. In other domains of science, to really say that you've got a cast iron case that you've proved causality, you would use something like a double blind design. In other words, you take a replicate set of treatments and you randomly assign them to two treatments, greenhouse gases and no greenhouse gases. Okay, so imagine we've got 10 planets or 20 planets or how many it takes. We randomly assign some of them to have higher CO2 and some that don't have higher CO2. And the person who's studying them is not allowed to know, okay, which ones were assigned to which. That's the famous double-blind, kind of test. So you sort of can do that a little bit with planets because there are quite a lot of planets around. And so you can, for instance, look at Venus and Mars, you know, which have very, very different atmospheres from what we do. They're also different distances from the sun, but we can calculate their radiant intensities. And in fact, the predictions of what their climate should be work out spot on. You know, okay, that's fine. But in general, we only have one Earth. Okay, we only have one Earth with this unique sort of, you know, circumstances, and you can't do a randomized controlled experiment. We are doing an experiment on it. You know, people have described climate change as the sort of, you know, world's great experiment, but there's no control. So how would we replace in a situation that notion of a randomized control when you can't do it? Well, the way we do it these days is by modeling. We can create model worlds, okay, and we can replicate those. We can replicate them thousands of times. We can manipulate the treatments that are associated with them. Not only do we do that in one model with lots of runs, thousands of runs, we also actually have probably at this stage 35 major modeling groups around the world working on this. Okay, not strictly independently, that's true, because they share code and that sort of stuff, but they are in fact quasi-independent kind of tests. And so when you see those projections of climate change going forward, what you'll usually see is a fat band, okay, a sort of an average number and a fat band around it. That's what that fat band is. Okay, it is the results of this whole what's called ensemble of models. And you can demonstrate that the results of an ensemble are a much more robust approach to projection than simply relying on one model. Okay, that's sort of portfolio theory. So what you can do is you can take the record, okay, and here it is here. So we're expressing it in terms of temperature anomaly relative to a reference state, which is the 1860 climate. So we believe that anthropogenic climate change has been going on at least since about 1750, but really we only had global measurement systems, reliable measurement systems, since about 1860. The first climate records in South Africa were taken in 1850, at the observatory in Cape Town, and there's been a steadily growing number of those around the world ever since. So we've got modern temperature records since then. We can estimate the climate before that, but we have to use proxies. So we use things like tree ring widths, and we use the depth of uncompacted snow in glaciers and proxy records like that too. But that's always a proxy, okay? Whereas the actual measurements we have since 1860. So we normalize everything to that. And when we, so that there, okay, these colors don't show up very nicely here, but that there is the global climate system as observed. And the wiggly lines, which are not showing up particularly well here, okay, are the model results. Okay, so when you can see. Now we can play the experiment. We can disaggregate, and we say, if we force the models, okay, with all the natural things that we know about. So we put in orbital forcing, we put in all the volcanoes, we put in all the stuff that we know influences the climate. What we can see is that the model results vary, okay, but there's no trend in them. It's noise. Okay, so it's a fat band of noise. Whereas the observations go up. If we only put in the greenhouse gas forcing, okay, that's this here, and the red line is the mean of it, it actually slightly overestimates the observed warming. The difference is the other things which humans are doing to the climate. So there are things that humans do to the climate which reduce the warming, and one of the key things is land cover change. Okay, so land cover change reduces greenhouse gases, and that's already considered in there, but it also changes the surface reflectivity of the Earth, which slightly cools the Earth. There's also things to do with aerosols in the atmosphere, which help to reflect things. So it's only when we put together the human effect and the natural effect that we get the model results, which is the red, okay, the average, closely reconstructing the observed. Okay, it's really quite remarkably good over many, many models. I'm trying to remember what the right-hand panels were, and I can't, so I'm going to leave it as sort of the anomaly analysis. But here is the breakdown, then, of how these different forcings work out. So that's the observed global warming. Okay, it's about, at the stage this analysis was done, it was 0.6 above whatever the reference was, which was probably 1860 to 1900. Okay? All right? The greenhouse gas forcing alone would have suggested around about 0.8. Okay? But the other anthropogenic forcing, specifically land use, would have suggested minus 3. So you take that from that, and that's there what the suggested anthropogenic forcing is. Very close to the observed and within the error bar. That there is the net natural forcing. Tiny. Tiny. The actual natural net forcing is very, very small, and its error bar does not really come close. And this one here is due to the internal dynamics of complex systems. So when you have a complex nonlinear system, it wobbles all by itself without any forcings whatsoever. It's just kind of natural, you know, dynamics. And you can see the natural dynamics don't explain it either. That's their variability there. It doesn't explain the observed. Okay, you can do exactly that same analysis. That was the analysis for the whole world, but you can unpack that analysis at whatever scale you like, reasonably. So here, it's unpacked for Africa, there for the South Atlantic, there for the Indian Ocean, for all the different parts of the world, and you get exactly the same thing. It's only when you put the anthropogenic forcing into the models that you get a reproduction of the observed. Okay, if you leave that out, you get noise, but you don't get any secular trend. So that really is the basis on which we can say with a high degree of confidence that the dominant cause of the observed changes we've seen is anthropogenic. It's not the exclusive cause. There are other things in there. There are natural forcings. There is internal dynamics, but by overwhelmingly large margin, the dominant cause is the human effect. It becomes a lot more complicated when we move away from the climate itself to the things that climates impact. And so very often as people, we don't actually care about the climate per se. You know, that's sort of of academic interest. What we care about is things like food supply or water supply or the existence of other species. So there's a whole bunch of things which are one step removed from climate. And it becomes a lot more difficult doing the detection and attribution of those things than of the climate system itself. There's a bunch of reasons for that. The first is we have really actually very good data on the climate system. We've been collecting, you know, detailed numerical data about it for, you know, a century and a half. We don't necessarily have that quality of information worldwide about other things, flowing rivers, presence or absence of species, or what have you. So that's the first problem. The second problem is the further you work away from the climate signal itself, the more multiple causality you've got. So almost any phenomenon will have several causes, and unscrambling that lot, okay, becomes more complicated the more steps away you get. But nevertheless, from around the world, and this really doesn't show up on this background at all. There's a map of the world behind this. Okay, you can't see it. Okay, and these symbols here, okay, represent the different things which have been detected to be changing in the modern era. So in every single part of the world, there are a bunch of things which have been changing. Water supplies, fisheries, the occurrence of fire, just to pick the ones out of Africa, agricultural production, human health, many, many metrics of things have changed. So demonstrating change is fairly straightforward, okay? Demonstrating the attribution is where it becomes difficult, okay? And only a subset of those things can you say Well, all of those have been definitively attributed to climate, okay? They haven't necessarily been definitively attributed to anthropogenic climate change rather than necessarily natural climate variation. Okay, very subtle difference. Look, guys, we've shown that the climate change is not natural, it's human. That doesn't translate into showing that things which are affected by climate therefore are being driven by the human side of it rather than the anthropogenic side of it. Okay, it gets a bit messy. Right. This just illustrates that point. I'm not trying to get you to read all of this information, but just the point is that these are kind of climate drivers at this end, and they go through a whole set of causal cascades to the things that we really care about, you know, which are further down the chain. And some of those we've been able to do attribution studies on, others we just don't have the quality of data to do it. But it's interesting because the impacts world, which is the world that I live and work in, is at this stage where the climate people were maybe 15, 20 years ago. So at that stage, they were very strong on detection. They were only just starting to get into the attribution, you know, scene and making progress there. We're now, they're now strong on attribution. We're now learning those techniques. We're strong on detection. We have many, many fewer examples of attribution. Okay, so let's take a classic example. When we have an extreme weather event, whatever it is, a giant hailstorm in Johannesburg or a strong drought such as the one we currently experienced, my phone and Mary's phone rings off the hook. Okay, every journalist in, you know, the southern hemisphere and more wants to know, is this one climate change? Okay, so there's a fundamental problem there, is that climate is by definition the statistical average of weather. So you can't ever say that a weather event is climate change. Okay, it's just simply one sample out of a statistical, you know, package. So you can't really say, that hailstorm, no, that one was climate change. Okay, you just can't do that. But on the other hand, if you see a sequence of such events, okay, in other words, you've taken those events and you've themselves turned them into statistics rather than individual events. Now you're comparing statistics with statistics, and the standard approaches for statistical comparison work, provided you've satisfied all the assumptions. What you can say, the pattern of weather has changed. Okay, so you can say, and that applies to extreme events as much as it does to averages. It's much more difficult with extreme events because by definition there's fewer of them. So your sample size is typically smaller, and that's why it takes a lot of time. But you can do that, and it has been done for quite a lot of extreme events. Okay. Secondly, you can even do this with an individual event. Okay, if your individual event is clearly so far out of the distribution that you've established historically that it's implausible that it is drawn from that distribution. You could say from an individual event, that one, in fact, is most likely to be associated with climate change. So let's talk a little bit about the 2015-2016 El Nino and the heat waves which have accompanied it, notably in Johannesburg, or in fact the whole country over the last 2 months, and the drought which has been in place for essentially the last 2 years. First point is that El Niños, which is this global perturbation of ocean circulation which then propagates through the atmosphere, have occurred for thousands of years. We have great evidence of that. For instance, one of the classic things with El Niño, which starts off as this accumulation of warm water on the eastern side of the Pacific, is in those years the anchovy run in the Humboldt Current fails. So they have a year where they don't have a whole bunch of anchovies, whereas the La Niña years, they've got a bunch of anchovies. And of course, those little anchovies only live for a year, and they die, and they sink to the bottom of the ocean, and they get built into the ocean sediments at the bottom. And if you send down a corer and go through all that slime and mud at the bottom and pull it up, you have a set of layers year by year of how many fishes there were. Okay, and so from proxies like that, you can reconstruct what the historical frequency of El Nino events was. We can do that much closer to home. We have proxy records from tree rings. Some colleagues of mine have deconstructed baobabs and worked out for Southern Africa. We can get that information from the growth rings on stalactites. There's all sorts of things. Even going back in the written records, looking at newspaper records going back 200 years about what the drought situation was, you can build up a picture which says that El Niños up until 1990, in Southern Africa, you would expect about one a decade. It's not periodic, it's not a cycle, okay? But it has a recurrence of around about one a decade. And we got really, really good at predicting El Nino droughts. So in the 80s in particular, we kind of cracked the code. And it was just a question of getting this thing called the ENSO signal, which is the ratio of the pressure at Darwin to the pressure at Tahiti divided by some other stuff. It's just a set of indicator numbers. And we could say, if it goes to that number, you know, for the next 6 months or 12 months, you know, this will be the rainfall situation in South Africa. We made a prediction on that basis in 1995. It was spectacularly wrong. Okay, now that's serious. Okay, if the weatherman predicts it's going to rain tomorrow and it doesn't rain, it's not a big deal. Or if he says it's not going to rain and you go out and you get wet, it's not a big deal. If you tell the whole country not to plant mealies, okay, they don't plant mealies and the rain's just fine, okay, you've actually seriously damaged the economy and you've seriously damaged a lot of people's livelihoods. So that was a bit embarrassing. And the next one kind of failed as well. So something had gone on, and this wasn't just us, this was around the world, with this ability to kind of predict El Nino consequences 18 months ahead of time was failing all over. So something has changed, you know, in the underlying dynamics of El Nino. For instance, during the period from 1995, and that's when we sort of first kind of started failing at this thing, through to the period 2013, the global mean air temperature, that wiggly line I showed you in the previous graphics, actually hadn't gone up. It had wobbled all over the show. So some years were higher and some years were lower. But if you took a line and you went from 1995 and you did a regression through those 20 years of data, it was a flat liner. And of course, all the skeptics immediately leapt up and said, aha, gotcha. Okay, the CO2 level has been climbing, and there's lots of evidence of that. You're saying CO2 causes global climate change. Look, the CO2 went up, and the climate didn't go up. Case closed. Well, global mean air temperature is the thing that we use for kind of proxying global climate change, but it's a very poor measure. And the reason is this, is that the air has a very, very low heat retention capacity. You can't store heat in air very well. In fact, all the heat that gets stored in air gets stored in its water vapor, essentially. The heat storage of the world is in the oceans and in the ice bodies. And when we look at the changes in temperature of the oceans and the ice bodies, and we have quite sophisticated ways of doing that, moored arrays and all sorts of things, it had been steadily going up during that period from 95 through to 2015. So there was just 2013. There was a steady increase in the heat content of the world. It simply wasn't going into the atmosphere. It was being ported into the ocean. And the outcome of that has to be basically an El Nino event at some stage. Okay, you've built up all this heat, particularly in the ocean, and it has to break out someplace. And kind of that's what happened in 2015, 2016. Very, very strong El Nino signal. And in the interim, colleagues of mine at the CSIR had developed a new way of taking the ocean signal and translating it into a South African climate signal. So previously this had been done by statistical correlation. If the El Nino index number was this, rainfall in South Africa would be that, standard correlative approach. Now, they were all, you were all taught many times, again, that, that correlation is not causation, it's simply an empirical association. And something had changed in the machinery of how that signal got translated to this signal. So what they did is, instead of doing a statistical correlation like that, they took the warmth signal in the oceans, which we know with a great deal of detail, and fed it into a climate model, okay? Because it's the oceans that really control the circulation of the Earth. And so you forced the climate model with the observed ocean signal and then ran it forward for 2 years. The reason that that works is, firstly, the ocean has this, you know, very big signal relative to the atmosphere. It changes slowly. The atmosphere is up in the morning and down at the night, and it's all, you know, it has a very short memory to it. The oceans have a huge memory to it. So what actually happens with an El Nino, you get this big, you know, bit of warm water in the eastern Pacific, and it's separated, the oceans are very deep, they're six kilometers deep. There's a very sharp transition between the hot water on the top and the cold on the bottom, the thermocline. It's absolutely sharp. What happens is you get a wave set up in that thermocline. So don't think of a wave on the surface of the ocean. Think of a wave in this separation. Think of it as kind of oil floating on water, and you set up a wave in that. And once that starts, once it starts from Peru propagating across the Pacific Ocean is half the world, nothing can stop it. Okay? It's going to propagate across the Pacific Ocean and until it hits Indonesia. And that process takes about 12 to 18 months. And so you know exactly how this will unfold over that period. And that's what gives you the predictability. If you can then translate that ocean dynamic into the pressure cells around the world in the atmosphere, which is ultimately what controls whether we get rain in summer or not. Most summers, anchored over southern Africa, is a low pressure cell. The pressure cells, the Hadley cells in the world, have to be an integer number. You can't have half a cell. Okay, so there's high pressure, low pressure going around the Earth. And when you develop an El Nino, they all get shifted one to the left. Okay, so our low pressure cell, which normally is over southern Africa in the summertime, and sucks in anticyclonically warm air from the Indian Ocean, laden with air, brings it over Botswana and dumps on us. That's where our rainfall comes from. That low pressure shell gets sent out over the South Atlantic Ocean and rains like billio there, okay? And the high pressure cell, which was over the southern Indian, comes and anchors on us. And high pressure cells circulate the other way, and the air is descending so it doesn't rain. And so we get then a dry period. And they were able to simulate that. And last year, the year before this current year, predicted that there would be an abnormally dry period. And so there was. Wasn't a big fanfare about it because they didn't want to like mouth off about it after the previous embarrassments. And then this year they also said there will be a dry year this year, and there was. So this ability has apparently been recreated. And as a result of the El Nino 2015-2016, high temperature records have been broken all around the world. The world as a whole was the hottest year on record. It significantly exceeded the next hottest year, which was 2014. Okay, and in South Africa, records fell just about everywhere. This was the hottest year on South African record as well. And so that has two components. Okay. The one component is the El Nino. When we have El Ninos, we have hot weather. Okay, that's always been true. So that's just a natural dynamic. When we have El Ninos, we have hot weather. But added on to that was the fact that the baseline has been rising. Okay, so Southern Africa has risen, its baseline temperature has risen at about twice the global rate. So the global rate relative to pre-industrial for the world is around about 0.8, 0.9 above pre-industrial. South Africa, it's 1.5. Okay, we rise twice the global average, 1.6 actually. And that is because of our location in the descending air tropical areas. Okay, so the sort of climatology of that is well understood. So the contribution that we have from the warming, the baseline warming, is in the region of 1.5 degrees. The temperature anomaly due to El Nino is in a similar order of magnitude. So we can say that the contributions of the natural El Nino dynamic and the human part of it are, you know, in the same order of magnitude for temperature. They both contribute. The analysis for rainfall is a bit trickier. When we have an El Nino, we generally have dry areas in South Africa, and it's a massive difference. We get like 50% less rainfall than we normally get. Whereas our projections for climate change are in the order of about 10%. Okay, same signal, same direction, but the climate change component of that is 10%, the El Nino component is 50%. The variation in rainfall is much more strongly due to the El Nino phenomenon than it is to climate change. That leaves unanswered the question, and as yet is unanswerable, is has the dynamic of El Nino been altered by climate change? Is this discontinuity that we see up to the 1990s period, now we seem to be another dynamic, is that because we've crossed a climate change threshold? It is consistent with the modeling, but the record, if we only get one El Nino every decade, more or less, and we've only had 2 decades since that, you know, since the record jumped its groove, you really can't say, you know, with scientific, you know, credibility, yes, it has changed due to climate change. We think it might have. Okay, watch this space, but we can't prove that. Okay, so given all the noise around climate change, a lot of people come to me and say, but, you know, how do we sort out what you're saying? It sounds very plausible, okay? But then they're going to listen to some other guy, and he sounds very plausible, and, you know, so what do I do? So either you kind of give up and say, well, screw it, and go on and do something else. Or you say, they kind of cancel each other out, nothing must be going on, or whatever. So how do we go about separating out who to believe from who not to believe? Well, first of all, all scientists are skeptical. Okay? I don't want to meet a scientist who isn't skeptical. It's the hallmark of being a scientist is always to take nothing for granted. What's that famous dictum of the Royal Society, which is the kind of founding society of Enlightenment science? It's basically in Latin, but it translates into don't believe anything that you see. Okay, don't believe anything that you hear, actually. Nothing that you is received wisdom should you accept. You should always, you know, kind of poke it to see whether it stands up. And so all scientists are skeptical, and climate scientists I work with, well, are an extremely skeptical bunch and fight vociferously about all these kind of things. So those, it's not like, you know, there's a big conspiracy to all, you know, have the same story. However, you have to follow the rules of evidence that apply in science, okay? And you have to acknowledge the uncertainties. That's why the error bars are there, okay? That's why the statements are hedged about with all that verbiage of, you know, highly likely or not likely or unequivocal or whatever. That's a hallmark of science being done in its legitimate mode. On the other hand, the people who I would classify as denialists as opposed to skeptics will stick to their message regardless of the evidence that's provided. So they will raise something, and it's always the same story, you know, it's been going on for 20 years. Oh, but what about this? It's all about volcanoes. No. We've conclusively proven it's not volcanoes, okay? And here's the evidence. Next time you meet into them, it's about volcanoes. You know, it's just like stuck record. You just go back to it. So people who stick to the same set of explanations regardless of the information which is provided, you know, are basically not interested in looking at the evidence. They have some other agenda. And here's some kind of rules that you can use to try and pass out Not everyone is a climate scientist, not everyone is a scientist. You as an ordinary person, how do you try and sift, and this doesn't only apply to science, to climate science, it applies to all of the areas where, you know, there's public disputation. Firstly, do they actually have qualifications and a track record for making the statements that they make? If you look at, for instance, the three or four major denialists in South Africa, okay, one's a retired civil engineer, okay, long retired, I might point out. Two are in the nuclear industry, okay. The third is a communications consultant, okay. There's not a climatologist amongst them, okay. They have no publication record in climate science, okay. They never studied it, okay. They will spout off about it, but they have no legitimacy, they have no credibility to make those statements. Secondly, when they offer evidence, do they actually present the evidence, or is it an assertion? Okay, if it's simply assertions, there's really nothing you can do about it. The climate has changed. No, it hasn't. Yes, it has. No, it hasn't. Yes, it has. You know, it's like that Monty Python skit. It doesn't go anywhere. It's only if you're willing to be able to provide the evidence, which is then testable, okay, and verifiable, then you can break that kind of deadline. And that kind of is associated with this one there. Do they publish in peer-reviewed journals, or is everything that they write in the newspapers or on a blog site, okay, untested? I'm not by this claiming that the peer-reviewed literature is perfect. It makes mistakes too, lots of documentation of that, but at least it's self-correcting. Okay, it's out there, it can be scrutinized, people can go back afterwards and say, you know, show me your original data, and there's been lots of cases of that, not only in climate science but elsewhere. But you have a way of going and testing the evidence. Whereas if everything that you publish is in the Bronco Sprint, you know, newsletter of the Horticultural Society, okay, then you kind of raises a bit of a flag here. There is a kind of a counter-argument to that. It's, oh, well, you know, these climate guys are a big club, you see, and they refuse to publish anything that doesn't agree with their findings. I guess that could happen, okay? It couldn't happen for long. You know, any of you who've been exposed to the body of science, you know, will know that there's nothing so much, especially that a young kind of starting career scientist would like to do, than to punch a hole in an existing theory. Okay, so this idea of this giant conspiracy where every scientist in the world agrees, you know, to some, you know, hoax story, it just can't happen. Okay? Quite apart from the fact is, how would we go back retrospectively and change 150 years of, you know, weather records taken all around the world, and how would we miraculously go in there and change the tree rings and all that sort of stuff? It's just, it's a nice conspiracy story, but it just actually isn't plausible. Okay, it doesn't pass the Occam's razor test. And then, are they repeating, you know, the same story? It's not only they are individually repeating the same story, but often you'll find the same story coming out of a whole bunch of different denialist sources because they share resources. Okay, so you'll suddenly see the fashion is for this year, it's all about the hiatus. Oh, but what about the hiatus? And you've got to deal with all this stuff. You know, next year is the next thing, and it's a kind of consistent pattern. So, you know, if that's the basis of the discussion, usually, you know, it's a kind of a conspiracy theory idea. All right, so I've skipped over a lot of topics here. I haven't told you a lot about climate change in Southern Africa directly, nor about its impacts. If you want to read about that, all this and more, okay, is in the book which is on sale over there, where we take the material which has been scientifically treated by things like the IPCC, and firstly downscale it to Southern Africa to say, well, how does it affect South Africa? Most of us don't live in the whole world, we live in a particular place. And secondly, we try to translate it into terms which are scientifically correct, because you can get oversimple with this stuff, but hopefully are understandable to people who are intelligent but not necessarily trained as scientists or specifically climate scientists. That's what we set out to do in this book, and also to take it beyond just climate into impacts, and then finally into, so what can we individually and collectively do about it? Because the final kind of defense, if you like, of the denialist community, if you've proven that the climate has changed, if you've proven that it is predominantly human, the next thing they raise is, well, yeah, it's changed, but it hasn't changed that much to cause us a problem. If you've then proven that the degree of change is enough to cause massive economic and human suffering problems, the final level of the final defense is, well, there's nothing we can do about it anyway. Or if we did something about it, we'd cause more damage than not doing anything about it. And that ultimately comes down to me to a philosophical position. You know, when faced with difficult problems, do you take a fatalistic position and say, you know, we're all toast, let's have another drink, or do you push back against it? And for me, and I think for most of humanity, our position has always been to fight the impossible, okay, to look for solutions to this. And I think there are a lot of solutions which collectively can certainly, at this stage, we can't avoid a significant amount of climate change. We've already undergone quite a lot, and we will undergo quite a lot more, no matter what we do. But we can keep ourselves out of the kind of worst-case scenario where no adaptation is possible. And to do that, we really have to engage with it substantively soon and, you know, with energy. So that's the end of the formal presentation.